September 14th, 2015, Community Planning and Development Commission. First up on our agenda is the public hearing for the accessory structure special permit at 20 Walker's Brook Drive, the paper store. We've got a public hearing legal notice to be read. Yeah, no problem.
Notice is hereby given under section 4.4 and 5.5.1.I.1 of Reading zoning bylaw. Community Planning and Development Commission will hold a public hearing on Monday, September 14th, 2015 at 7:30 p.m. in the Selectmen's Meeting Room at Reading Town Hall, 16 Lowell Street, to hear the request for a special permit for an accessory structure located at the property addressed as 20 Walker's Brook Drive, Assessor's Map 17, Lot 132, for the use of storage by the paper store. The applicant is requesting a special permit in accordance with Section 5.5.1.I.1 for use of a truck trailer for storage. Copy of the application and associated plans are available to the public in the Community Services Department at Town Hall, Monday through Thursday, 7:30 a.m. to 5:30 p.m., and Tuesdays from 7:30 a.m. to 7 p.m.
All right. Good. Assume somebody's here for this? Okay, great.
Yeah.
Thank you for coming. Perfect. All right. So we'll run this. We'll ask Gene to kind of baseline us based on the conversations that have been had, give you an opportunity to speak, and we'll ask questions along the way. If anyone from the public has any comments, we'll ask them to weigh in and then take it from there. So go ahead, Gene. Thanks.
Okay, so this is a request for a special permit. This is now under the new zoning bylaw. We allow accessory structures in industrial areas like this by special permit from the CPDC. So that's why it's before you. There's some material in the packet with comments. In particular, the fire chief had a few issues that he had some questions on. We do have a plan that shows the accessory structure. It's a trailer. And the trailer has been there for a long time, and I think the goal here is just to legitimize that as a storage area. And the decision is written so that any of the other issues that need to be worked out around whatever the fire chief would be comfortable with or anything, there's some latitude in the decision, so that we can come back to that as a staff initiative and work that, those details out. The concern was that there wasn't a stamped plan, so we didn't feel that that was 100% on the money. But I think we can work with what we have.
Okay.
And as I say, any of the details related to concerns that have come up, we can work through a stamped plan and figure out a way to make this kind of thing work.
Okay. Great, thanks, Gene. Is there anything you want to add to that?
Not really. I mean, you know, that's one of our biggest stores in the chain, so we've created the necessity for some additional storage out back, especially during holiday seasons.
That's vital to the operation of that building. If we don't have that there, concerned that we'll lose quite a bit of sales volume in that building. We won't be able to do what we need to do in that building.
Mm-hmm. Understood.
We've had it there for about, what, 8 years?
Okay. Any questions? John, Dave, and Nick?
Yeah, I'd like to see a plan with some detail. Can you zoom in on it? Is it as shown in this aerial, which shows some kind of...
I assume... Gene, you referenced a plan. Is this it, or is there something else that?
I think this. There were a couple kicking around, but I think this is probably the one that shows it the clearest.
Yeah, the I looked at the electronic stuff when the photos show it better actually than the plan does. I mean, one of the concerns is, of course, the OEA storage unit, which is chock-a-block next to yours. And I guess it's behind your portion of the store as well, because they've got the access door tucked in the corner.
Yeah, the door that brings our freight in, like in our regular truck kit service, is over there.
Okay, so the door in the corner is your delivery door as well as theirs?
No, that just leads, well, this door, I brought some of the photos that I had submitted. This door here is where we receive our freight. I'm not
okay.
sure.
Yeah, this plan, maybe.
Oh yeah. I'm not sure where they receive their freight, but it's not through. We don't share the receipt.
It's our own door, yeah. It's not blocked by their, by, I don't know how you say, police trailer.
Okay, but if you were at some point in the future to remove the truck trailer storage area, you'd have to move their container first.
You would have to coordinate
first.
With them.
Right.
Yeah.
Yes, correct.
Okay. And I know from the correspondence discussions that the trailer is more or less an extension of the building, so it's got facilities, you know, electricity and so forth from the building?
Yeah.
Yes, there is an overhead door, a dock door. The trailer abuts right next to it.
Yeah, but the, like the fire chief was wondering about sprinklers or any other thing, if it were in fact up to code as if it were a part of the building, an extension of the building.
So there is, like, there are lights in there. There's electricity. I do not believe there's sprinklers, correct?
Okay.
Can't see anything. It's kind of frustrating. This is what we, this is the picture.
Oh,
The color ones here if you want.
So you have a door. The paper store has a door out the back, and Oyes has a door out the back, correct? And something right there says egress door for Oyes. Is that true? I'm not pointing to anything, but I assume there's a door back there that counts as an egress point.
So
yes or no?
Can I show you?
No, I just want to know, and I want an answer. I mean, is there a door back there that counts as an egress door from the building?
Yes.
So what you've done is you've position these structures beyond the egress point that does not comply with the building's approved construction. Now the steel container could probably contain the fire for a while without a sprinkler, but the other structure is made of what?
Steel metal.
Well, what kind of steel? Like a steel shipping container?
Yeah,
or
yes. Different than an 18-wheeler unit. And it gets closed off every evening with the...
So if you built a shed back there, if you built something out of 2x's or steel even for that matter, adjacent to the building, within 5 feet of the building, it basically counts as an addition to the building. But now you have an addition to the building which does not meet the code for which the building was approved. The building is sprinklered, I assume.
Yes.
And this addition is not. And there needs to be a firewall between them. I doubt that back wall is fire rated. So, I mean, the building inspector and the fire marshal are the ones who should be saying something here. Those would be the kind of concerns I have. You know, you can't just put this stuff back there. Great, so your store needs more storage. Well, then the building has to be expanded. Or something has to be done that meets code. I don't know if the containers have smoke alarms in them if they're not sprinklered. Are there any other openings in that wall behind this container? Windows up high?
Nope.
Something that the
no.
fire department would then not have access to because this is in front of it?
Yeah.
Now see if you can spin the compass around in the upper right-hand corner. Just grab that north arrow and grab the N and drag it around. There you go.
There you go.
Now zoom in on that. So the big container is the paper store and the small container is Oyes. Where's the door?
Right in the inlet. There's one there and there's one.
So we receive our deliveries through the store here, and the trailer is backed up to an overhead dock.
It's part of the building if it stays there permanently. What's all this stuff on the right here behind OEAs and Starbucks?
That's dumpsters.
Dumpsters, okay.
Dumpsters and inappropriate things that we have to discuss.
Well, I mean, my biggest concern is addressed in that they're against the building and they don't block the road access all around, which makes it easier for fire apparatus to get through. That's critical. If the building inspector and the fire marshal have no problem with the construction of these the way they're located, then I'm not going to object to it. But I would never stamp that drawing. And I don't know what your insurance company says when they see this, or if they even know about
it. It's insured.
It is insured.
Really?
Yeah. All the contents
That's
in it.
That's pretty amazing. Mm.
So other than the email, have we gotten any feedback from the fire chief?
He wanted to see a stamp drawing.
So he's still okay?
Yeah.
I'd like to see that too. I want to see who stamps that. And somehow justifies it via the code, via language that says that it's permitted. Because, again, you have an if this is considered part of the building, it's unsprinklered, and it's lower than the building adjacent to it, which means either the roof of the structure or the wall behind it has to be fire rated.
Has to be what?
Fire rated.
Oh.
Because you're saying, here's one type of construction and sprinklered,
yep.
And here's this storage unit, which is over 100 square feet, which would be required to be fire rated or sprinklered. And you've got a condition where the container could start burning through its top and go through the wall above it.
Mm-hmm.
Those are just issues I see. Again, mm-hmm. Fire marshal and the building inspector are the final authority on that. I'm glad that the roadway is clear because that does help. And they are tucked away, so it's not really a front of the building kind of issue.
Right.
But in essence, the trailer is no different than a trailer if it was movable. From a...
Well...
From a loading dock?
From what point of view? If it is, you know, if it's powered and ventilated and so on and so forth as an extension of the building, then it's an extension of the building.
I mean, I was just thinking of it from a fire perspective. Is if they pulled up a movable trailer there every day, the same.
And if it caught fire, you could move it away. Which is not the case.
Only if you had a tractor trailer to come and pull it away.
Does it actually have wheels on it?
Yeah. I'm going to say, you know, if this doesn't happen, we have to get rid of the trailer. What's going to end up happening is I'm going to have to bring an 18-wheeler there with product and fixtures every day. It's going to get dropped, and they'll come at the end of the day and pull it out. The next morning, they'll come back and bring the delivery just like a grocery store would or any other large retailer.
Yeah, I mean, we're trying to avoid that. We understand how you need to use it. I'm just telling you issues. I see it. You could say it's a trailer, John, but, you know, what if you put a bathroom in there and and beds and you rented it out like a unit.
Yeah.
Say it's a mobile home,
yeah,
but it's not.
The differences are important, but just in a functional standpoint, it is no difference.
But it's not being used that way. I mean, it's being used as permanent storage. It's powered. It's not moving.
Mm-hmm.
And so whatever the building inspector and fire marshal want is what I would agree to.
And that's how we should phrase the decision.
There's a fuel load in here, right? And this is a paper store. It's all paper or candles or something. And that roll-up door's not fire-rated for sure. If it's even closed, do you roll the door down?
Yep.
Is it's not? Is it a weather-tight?
Yes.
Seal.
Our dock door on there is metal sealed shut.
Do you have one of those dock extenders? Is that what you have that hugs the...
Like a, to go into the trailer?
Yeah.
Yep, it's a metal plate that comes in and out.
Yeah, it's just a regular door though. It's not rated. It doesn't have a fusible link on it or anything. I mean, again, so those are my concerns, really, for those two pieces. Mm-hmm. We're only talking about the first one right now, though, right?
Will a stamp plan answer all or address all the concerns that you have? It doesn't seem like they would. They would.
The code gives the inspector a lot of latitude. If the and the fire chief knows better than anybody what he has to deal with and how he wants to be alerted to things. If he says he wants a wired smoke detector in there, which there might be for all I know.
I mean, we get inspected yearly by the fire department running in the store.
Yeah, so if those are the guys that have to go in there,
yeah.
And if they're okay with it, and somebody stamps a plan that says this meets code somehow, mm-hmm. I'm not going to stand in the way of that.
Yeah, it's the same kind of thing. We have no objection to it as long as the appropriate approvals are in place.
They want whatever they want in there. Well, we can
you're not blocking egress. You're not creating a worse fire hazard, I guess.
Okay. Anything else? As it relates to this one, because we're going to handle these separately, right, Jean?
Yeah, the separate public hearing.
This one
and
Dwayne's. Okay. Anybody from the public here to make any comments? Okay. Are we okay to close the public hearing?
Move that we close the public hearing for the accessory structure special permit for the property at 20 Walker's Brook Drive, paper store.
Second.
All those in favor? Let's take a look at the decision.
Decision seems they have everything covered.
Yeah, I was going to say the same thing.
Why is it criteria 4.5? The findings, number one, says 4.4.5, right? The second paragraph says 4.4. We have to get used to all these renumbered sections.
That's where we say
laundry list of
what the special permit authority is of CPC.
Yeah.
Okay.
And then 5.5.1(i)(1) is accessory buildings or structures how they get permitted. And that last I says the following accessory structures may be allowed by special permit by the Community Planning and Development Commission in all districts, provided that such accessory structures meet all yard requirements. And then they list the different types of structures, including these kind of things.
Yeah.
And they do, because the property goes straight across there, it doesn't jog back. Right?
Right.
We're well behind the lines.
Yep, they're well within.
Yeah, the specific 551(i)(1) is a truck trailer used for storage or advertising.
Yeah.
So that's spot on the thing we're talking about.
So in the conditions, it talks about a certified plot plan or a plan being stamped. Is that what it is that you guys want stamped? A location plan as opposed to, say, a building permit plan?
Yeah, the fire chief wants to clearly understand where this falls on the site. And that was the email that we received, that he really didn't want to comment until he could see a stamped engineered site plan that showed this clearly.
Well, specifically probably the access and egress in the rear of the building. Because the most of the detail stuff we've had previously is of course on the retail front.
The exit potential is a very big concern.
Yeah.
And access to fire protection and access for fire apparatus. And they were also concerned about the possibility of combustible materials and the spacing in the building and lot lines. So mm-hmm. kind of standard for what fire looks at.
Where does it say that then?
That's the email dated August 19th from Chief Burns. It's on page...
No, but where in the conditions does it tell them that's what the plan needs to show? Because the only thing we're asking for is a stamped...
Well,
certified plot plan.
Yeah, it's the condition three, I think.
Okay, and has the building inspector weighed in on what he wants? He's going to make
yes.
you get a permit? Is he going to make them get a permit for an accessory structure, or is he going to make them get a... Is he going to look at code, the egress code and all that?
Yep.
Okay. And this is just a, this is not like a variance in that this is strictly for their use, for this tenant.
Correct.
Right.
So if you change tenants, you'd want to, when you presented that tenant's application, you'd have to talk about this, if they needed this again. So don't change tenants.
We don't want to go anywhere.
So you're good? Does this cover everything?
Yeah.
Okay.
Okay. Move that the CPDC approve the accessory structure special permit for the storage trailer at 20 Walkersbrook Drive for paper store.
Second.
All those in favor? All right.
All right.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
So you see Glenn, he's in on Tuesday.
Okay.
All right.
Thank you very much.
All right. Next up on our agenda is the public hearing for the accessory structure special permit 20 Walkersbrook Drive, Oye's Restaurant.
Notice is hereby given under section 4.4 and 5.5.1.I.3 of the Reading Zoning Bylaw. Community Planning and Development Commission will hold a public hearing on Monday, September 14th, 2014 at 7:45. In the Selectmen's Meeting Room at Reading Town Hall, 16 Lowell Street. To hear the request for a special permit for an accessory structure located at the property addressed as 20 Walkersbrook Drive, Assessor's Map 17, Lot 132, for the use of storage by Oye's Restaurant, the applicant is requesting a special permit in accordance with Section 5.5.1.I.3 for a steel storage unit. A copy of the application and associated plans are available to the public in the Community Services Department in Town Hall Monday through Thursday, 7:30 a.m. to 5:30 p.m., and Tuesdays from 7:30 a.m. to 7 p.m.
Great, thank you. So, Gene, are there any differences here as far as what we're needing between paper store and OEAs?
I think we're doing them separately. You say why we're doing them separately?
Yeah.
I think because they're separate tenants, even though they're part of the same building, they're looking for accessory structures, a special permit that would run to that different tenant.
Oh,
so we're doing them separately.
That makes sense. Okay. Anything you want to open up with? It seems pretty much identical.
Pretty much the same as what we just did. They have a need for the storage and the special permit avenue allows them to pursue it that way.
Okay.
Well, this one is somewhat different because it's freestanding, you know, it's a walk around from their walk around access rather than the direct loading dock, as I understand it. And it's less, I mean, it's more of a shed use than the roll up door.
It's less obviously not permanent. Sense. It's not a trailer. You can't claim that you're wheeling it away. But it's all of the same issues we just talked about.
Right, right. That was kind of my.
And in the zoning, we did make a provision for this. The other two categories were standalone shipping or storage container or a steel storage unit. So I think it qualifies.
Well, it does. One of the questions is the other stuff on the back of the building.
Do we want to go there now, or do we want to focus on the shed itself?
I don't think we have any issues with the shed now. We've already talked that through, and as long as the building department and the fire department are okay. That one's a little different, because it's not attached to the door, to an opening.
Mm-hmm.
This special permit request is for the container, not for the shed.
Oh, I see. Container. Okay. Sorry.
The shed appears as a code enforcement issue that we're working with the building inspector on.
So you're gonna deal with that?
Yes. Condition 9 in the draft.
Yeah. Okay. I thought we conditioned it when we did the new restaurants.
I think we said that we weren't going to issue any occupancy permits until this was straightened out, and the way that they straightened it out is to move forth to the board and then they have issues with the building inspector.
Okay.
That shed abuts Starbucks or Oye's?
It's Oye's shed, so it's
okay.
In the back there.
Okay.
Yeah, but it's from the plan, it appears to be behind the portion of the building that's occupied by Starbucks.
I'm trying to figure out.
Kevin, is it on the end? Is that where it is?
I'm sorry?
The shed.
The shed's behind the Starbucks, according to the plan.
Well, what's the question to you?
Where is the shed in the back there?
Right next to Starbucks dumpster.
Okay.
The one you just bring it up.
Yeah, that's
right. The plan, I think, is better.
This shed I did.
This one, yeah.
Those are material I take down one again, though. Used to be a two. Those material I just take down and leave on the side.
This material?
Yeah, we're taking those already. That's all put it.
You can see that the materials of the shed are inappropriate for that. Is that an oil? Is it a grease spill that I'm seeing? Fire grease? That big yellow spot?
That's the 2 weeks ago, the dumpster leaking, which replaced the dumpster.
That's almost at the corner of the building.
Is there a door back there, too? Is this in front of a door? See that steel door in the back?
It's the Starbucks that comes down by next week. I have a door there. That's for the other shed. I take it down. I put it in the front there. That's what the door covered the shed behind it.
All the way against the building wall, though?
It no, not like against the, no.
What's that door?
This again? Door come out from the other shed, I take it down. It used to be a two, so I take one down.
No, no, in
that's
the back.
The door from the other one.
All that's the way, yeah, that. Isn't that in the wall?
Yeah, there's, I mean, one of the pictures appears to show
this door here.
This door, this is my door right there. Can I go there?
Steel door and some electrical and or gas service.
So this stuff's in front of all that?
Yeah.
Take all the stuff down right now.
Because from this is my dumpster right here, it's my dumpster. That's one small one right against the dumpster. I take it down, that's why I put the door, everything that here in the front. And that's one small one behind this door. You can see right now, just because whoever take a picture, you take this door and then take a shirt behind. That's one shirt. Not all go to the door though. It's a separate one. That's one walkway to the Starbucks between the shirt to the building. Yeah,
that must be egress from Starbucks. It must be the door that gets out of the kitchen from the Starbucks then.
You say?
That must be an egress door that shouldn't be blocked. It should be a clear path.
Well, this is why I think we want to get this plot plan so we understand what's going on back there.
And I don't think you're supposed to have anything back there but the dumpsters.
So you're handling that separately through the code enforcement officer?
Yes, sir. The building inspector, yeah.
Building inspector?
Yep.
Okay.
I guess I'm not sure why we would not tie that to a special permit. I mean, that's typically what we've done. If there's any zoning compliance issues, this is where we have, this is where the buck stops here.
Yeah, you know, we tied it to the occupancy permit. So all of this has to be straightened out before any occupancy permits are going to be issued on the new development going in. The redevelopment plan with the new tenant's going to be the successor to Mac Grill. So that's where we tie it in. The building inspector is working on this as, I think, I don't know if there was any discussion, but I think the way they ended up is he felt as though it needed to have a building permit and it was a structure and not an accessory under our definitions
and,
here.
And when you're talking about this, you're talking about
the shed is treated a little bit differently.
The wooden shed, not the steel building.
Correct.
That's one thing in these conditions, because you talked about the special permit being for the
container.
The container,
yep.
And it's not clear when we say a building permit for a freestanding shed. I mean, we need to somewhere in here be clear about
yep.
the difference between the freestanding wooden shed structure versus the metal container, because we're having them go through two different processes.
But it's not finding two. Finding number two. And three, really.
Finding number two, conditions 9 and 10 are the ones.
Then why do we say anything in here about prior to any future tenant occupancy permits, the applicant shall file for a building permit for the existing freestanding shed. What's that in reference to in this document? So we need a finding saying there's a freestanding shed that's,
yep.
you
know, you're right.
We need to define
yep.
what that freestanding shed is.
As a placeholder almost.
Yes.
Okay.
Does that make
mm-hmm. Yeah, no, that makes sense.
Right. Or else the next person that picks this up will be as confused as I am.
Okay, so then what is the freestanding shed?
Yes.
Yeah, we have to figure that out. The freestanding shed is considered. Wait, the building inspector wants to consider that as a part of the main building?
I'm not sure if he's calling it part of the main building or just saying it doesn't really fit with these accessory buildings or structures. I'm not sure I think he had a hard time justifying it under the way the zoning is written for accessory buildings or structures.
Well, perhaps the finding we need is just a statement that there is one and it is not, it's non-compliant and not part of this
correct
decision.
Yep.
Just exclude it.
And so then don't put condition three in here.
Right.
You already.
It already lies in the approval for.
That you already have that condition three in somewhere else.
In the approval.
In the approval for.
For the overall redevelopment.
Yeah.
Yep.
Okay.
Could we add it to finding, the new finding number five?
Yeah.
As a reminder, refresh everyone's memory.
Yes.
And would just say.
The existing freestanding shed changes or approvals for the existing freestanding shed will be addressed prior to occupancy of. Whatever space you call that.
Yep.
Mm-hmm. Can do that.
But
it's
can,
a finding.
It's a finding.
It's a
finding.
Okay.
It. Yeah,
it's a finding.
Yep.
So you said that was number five. What's number four?
That there is a freestanding shed on the site that isn't part of this application,
okay.
All right.
This special permit. Just delete the freestanding shed from condition two.
You know what? We approved the prior one, and I believe it's signed by Jesse Wilson. So need to correct it on the prior prior decision and on this one, because they both say Jesse Wilson.
Yeah.
No, stop building stuff without permits.
Just ask a question.
Sure.
So just to play devil's advocate here, not to be unneighborly to our next door tenants, but ours goes and we're told we have to remove the building department or the fire chief says ours has to go. Theirs gets permitted because it's a steel structure. I'm going to need to be able to get in and out of that loading door with an 18-wheeler on a daily basis. If their trailer is permitted and left there, we will not be able to give access to our loading door. So I'm just playing devil's advocate of how that process would work at that point.
And I think that's the way we wrote the decision, so that we figure that out and
okay
we're not allowing something that doesn't work.
Okay.
Yeah.
Well,
take a look at them independently.
Yeah.
Permit them separately, but we got to look at them together.
Yes,
okay.
That's why we're asking for a stamped engineered plan, so we can
okay
understand
great. I just don't
how
get
that's
into
all
going to
work.
Theirs is there, ours is an
right
issue getting
sure
in and out.
Right.
Thank you.
Did you come?
No.
Oh. All right, well, the public hearing is still open. Any other comments from the public on this?
Move that the CBDC close the public hearing for the accessory structure special permit, Oye's Restaurant at 20 Walker Smith Drive.
Second.
All those in favor? I think we're good on the decision.
Okay. Move that the CBDC approve the accessory structure special permit as amended. for the steel storage container at 20 Walker's Brook Drive for use by Oye's Restaurant.
All those in favor? Thank you all.
Thank you very much. Yes. Yes.
All right. Next up. Approval not required, A&R plan for 49 and 55 Field Pond Drive. Gene, anything you want to kick us off?
Pretty straightforward.
Wait,
it's
been a while.
I'm not going to make a simple thing complex if I can help it.
Please
don't. It's simply a shifting between parent and children of a lot line between the houses to make one of them conforming where it's right now is non-conforming.
Mm-hmm. I had to do it with my own house here.
I also got a pen if you don't have it.
We have one. I can't say it right, but we have one.
Any questions, concerns?
Not a one.
All right.
So motion this?
A motion, man?
Move that the CPDC approve the A&R plan for 49 and 55 Field Pond Drive.
Endorse.
Thank you.
Endorse.
Second.
All those in favor?
Thank you.
All right. Sure.
Oh, you want to pick it up with George?
Yes, please.
Okay. Thank you very much.
And now, Fred, they're going to sign this now.
Brad? Did you say you had a pen?
It doesn't work.
I got my first name. And that's it.
We'll use that pen, Brad.
Oh, okay. Hopefully it's not dry.
Zoning amendment for subsequent town meeting, November 2015. So list memberships for CBDC and ZBA, and then consider a vote to include on the warrant. So we've got a special guest this evening. So Jean, anything you want to kick us off with?
Basically, this is per the AG. There was a general bylaw that spoke to this, and when the AG issued the approval, they flagged it and said this really needs to be part of the zoning bylaw, not the general, as it pertains to CPDC and ZBA. So that's why it's before you, and that's why the town manager's here.
And if you step back even further from the charter review committee, there was a lot of discussion that they had in terms of putting this in the charter. But as you may recall from town meeting floor, the issue of trying to decide what conditions associate members should or shouldn't vote is just too controversial to solve in the charter discussion and too confined. So the charter just allowed associate members and then said if there are other conditions, they'll be specified in the general bylaw or in the bylaws. So we had a general bylaw passed in April with no real expectation that the AG got the problem with it. But as Gene mentioned, the AG flagged these two committees. ZBA was not as much of a surprise, but CPDC was very much surprised to the town council. And what you see in front of you is two proposed sections that mirror the language that's in the general bylaw, except for each committee specifically, with the one exception being that CPDC may only have one associate member, whereas normally you'd have two. And the reason for that, I'll just read from town council. The Zoning Act allows planning boards to have one associate member who can vote on special permits. So one is underlined. That's it. So because of the Zoning Act, you are limited to one associate member, one formal associate member. So otherwise, I think they're both straightforward. This, the other wrinkle, I guess, is normally we have two-year terms for associate members, either one or two-year terms. But the charter did specify, again, because of state law, that any associate members of the ZBA would be three-year terms. That's, again, the requirement of state law.
For reasons that we don't understand. But
well, for reasons that may not make sense anymore. But So I don't think either of these is controversial. It completes what we thought we were doing before, with the differences being a three-year term from ZBA and then only one member for CPDC. There was some discussion because you had already had an associate member and another one that was interested in becoming an associate. So the selectman did not appoint a second one, obviously, for this reason. But as with some other committees, except for the voting, there's no limit on someone that's interested coming to meetings.
Mm-hmm.
You know, they don't have to be called an associate. Now there's an important distinction that an associate member could vote, so that becomes more important than it has been in the past. So the only other comment town council gave is we've chosen a draft bylaw to give the widest possible authority to the associate member. The precise limits of that authority could be up to the appointing board. And that's again what we did with the general bylaws for all boards and committees.
Right, so the intent here is not changed. It's just for bookkeeping purposes, moving it from one place to another.
Yep. And it was added to sections 4.3.3 and 4.5.3 that if you looked at the zoning bylaws, just logical. There are any sections that would follow.
So just as a way this might actually work in the real world, there's been times where we haven't been able to move on something because we needed four members.
Mm-hmm.
That's really the time. That's
where special permits.
Yeah. If the chair is someone is the one who is not able to make it, but the associate member is there, it the chair then can't designate the associate member, that associate member to deliberate because the chair is the one that's not there. Is there a way to move ahead on that?
Or? Yeah, the understanding is that there's always a chair at a meeting. So if the regular chair isn't there, he's designated one of you to be the chair for that meeting, and that applies.
Okay.
We did discuss that.
All right. Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Likewise, the chair may have to recuse themselves.
Right. Yeah.
Same idea.
Okay.
Makes sense. And the warrant closes tomorrow, is that mm-hmm. correct?
Okay. Not that this is last minute.
Yeah. And then, so assuming we vote to recommend this, we'll have a public hearing on the 5th, I think is that right?
Yep.
October 5th, and then we'll be on the warrant. Any concerns?
Nope.
No?
Good?
All right.
Other than how to word the motion. move that the CPDC
recommend for inclusion?
Recommend the proposed Article 10 zoning modification for inclusion for presentation to the subsequent town meeting.
To include as an article for November.
Okay. What he said.
Second.
All those in favor?
Subject matter of it, we get to the public hearing.
Yeah, and that's when we would make a report.
Yeah,
or a
vote
on whether to
right.
Right. To
plowing through this agenda. Good. Next up, roadway acceptance for subsequent town meeting, November 2015, Dividends Road, Causeway Road, and the subdivision roadway, Corey Lane.
Yes, maybe the first two.
I think we talked about this at the last meeting, I think you might recall. So the first two, we were looking for a certificate of completion from the CPDC and recommend acceptance. And then on dividends, it was to recommend acceptance of dividends, and then causeway to recommend acceptance of causeway. I think it was causeway that the engineers had an email in there that said the work's been done.
Yeah, $1,700.
Yep.
So that was,
I'm sorry, that was Corey.
Corey?
Yeah, we claimed the residual bond money and did the work.
So that was as of September 1st. I think it's pretty straightforward.
Okay. So are these the last few that
yes.
we're going to get them?
For this November, yeah.
Yep.
Okay. And then how many are left after that?
30 or 40.
Miscellaneous.
I don't think you'll see them. I think it's fair to say that after this batch going to November town meeting, there's probably money involved for improvements for residents for the rest of them.
These are the easy ones.
So, yeah. So for the selectmen, that's always been a couple of public hearings. You know, assessment of the betterments and the decision by the residents. And historically, it's taken a large majority of residents to sway the selectmen to assess betterments.
Okay. All right, good.
So, which of these things
So you have to actually sign some of this paper.
So we need a certificate of completion for Quarry Lane and then a recommendation for acceptance, right?
So Quarry Lane is the one that George, we talked with George about last
yep.
time.
Okay. Yep. Yeah, he's got a memo in here
dated
September 1st.
Yep. I just need to raise a manhole or something. Yeah.
Yeah, but they did. So move the CPDC issue a certificate of completion for Quarry Lane, Carriage Estates Phase 2, and Quarry Lane Estates.
Second.
All those in favor?
Move the CPDC to recommend acceptance of Quarry Lane as shown on the plan entitled Street Acceptance Quarry Lane, dated January 7th, 2013, to subsequent town meeting November 2015.
Second.
All those in favor?
Breaking the pattern.
Okay, so then we're going to Quarry Lane, Davins?
I think you need to, well, Quarry Lane, there's a form.
Yep.
So you want to sign.
Call.
Okay.
Oh, perfect timing.
Perfect timing?
Yeah.
You done?
We're on Quarry Lane.
Oh.
Is there something for us to sign?
So in other words, you're early and I'm late.
Same thing.
You're early.
These decisions all say Jesse.
Let the record show.
I was down here. It's all double signed. Fortunately,
I'm not.
So Quarry Lane.
Mine has. I think they're all holes in it. That's okay.
Yeah.
One in this? Is there one in this?
I have a single, but it has holes. Just.
Does it say Jesse?
He's a character. No.
Doesn't have Jesse paper?
No, that's for you guys to sign.
Do you have my? I just have a red pen.
Oh.
So in other words, I could stay home? Or I could have went home?
No. Miss all the fun? Tell us about the manhole cover?
Yeah, Quarry Lane, there was, we found two manholes that were completely buried. One was actually completely filled with gravel. We had to clean the drain line out also. We raised them, paved the street. There is no money to take. The bank released the remaining funds to the family. We've emailed the family to see if we get any kind of response, but so far we have not received anything. The bank shouldn't have released it because it was a joint bank account, but they did. So we're out of a little bit of manpower and two frames and covers. Not a big deal, but
why not have assessed the properties on the street?
Yeah.
Can't you just assess the properties on the street?
It's minor money. Believe me. I mean, if we exclude the labor, materials is maybe $1,000. Two frames and covers, some asphalt.
Okay. I think there might be.
My opinion is not worth assessing the rebutters on the street.
I think we might need one more vote to recommend acceptance to town meeting.
Oh, Corey. Corey Lane, did we not just vote that?
You voted. The release, certificate of completion, right?
Okay.
Yeah.
I think I did.
Well, let's do it again so we can change the name on the decision.
Issue a certificate of completion. Release the covenant.
Okay. Well.
Okay. It was to release from the covenant. There should be three votes. Mm-hmm. You voted to issue the certificate of completion. You voted to recommend acceptance to town meeting. The third one would be to release from the covenant.
Okay. The move that the CPDC release
Release all lots from the restrictive covenant.
Release all lots from the, on Corey Lane from the restrictive covenants.
Second.
All those in favor? Okay, so now we're good on Corey Lane. Now we're good with the dividends.
We're ready.
Okay. Move the CPDC recommend acceptance of Dividends Road as shown on the plan entitled Street Acceptance Plan Dividends Road dated May 3rd, 1999 to subsequent town meeting of November 2015.
Second.
All those in favor?
Oh, is so does that have a decision similar to this one? Is that not in my packet?
No.
There's no. Okay.
No, that's just to recommend.
Yeah, that was town council indicated that Dividends and Causeway were actually roadways in existence prior to subdivision control, so it didn't come before this board. So it was just a recommendation. So you don't have to. There's no other votes pertaining to subdivision that you have to take.
Okay. So we got the motion. We got a second. All those in favor?
Move the CPDC recommend acceptance of Causeway Street as shown on the plan entitled Street Acceptance Plan Causeway Road dated December 22nd, 2010 to subsequent town meeting November 2015.
Second.
Just a recommendation. It's a recommendation.
It's okay. Is it Causeway Street or Road?
Causeway Road.
Okay. So amended.
Okay. Sorry. Because I'm not sure if it was a typo. Okay. All those in favor? All right.
Now, in passing, I was curious. There's one of them where the line drawing, it wasn't clear which.
On Causeway?
Where the road actually is. Which dotted line or
this line? This portion right here is already a part of Causeway Road that's been accepted. It was laid out by the state on behalf of the town when they took all the properties for Route 93.
Okay.
It's from here to the end is what we're doing now. The reason why there's all these other lines is because we did betterment assessments, and so we had to show where their property lines out to the roadway come up.
I was curious about the dotted lines which appear to have the right-of-way over the property lines.
Yeah, not there,
what,
but for
what this is here is there was an original board of survey layout which laid out the roadway through here. The state redefined the roadway here and the roadway actually got built here. So this is.
So the dotted line is.
The dotted line was the proposed layout that the board of survey approved the layout of back in 1920 or something like that.
1924
as the second notation.
Okay.
All right. Good.
We'll keep
going.
What do we got left?
Yeah, we've got presentation. Yeah, I mean, we're almost done. Presentations, updates. All right, let's keep going.
Okay, so I can go home.
Thank you.
Came just in time.
Thank you. Review the draft town meeting presentations. So if you recall from our last meeting, I said I'd take a little bit of time and go through them, make some edits, which I did. I shared them back with Jesse, and that's the version that we have before us. I didn't change a lot of the content. I did a little bit of call outs. I tried to clean up the language a little bit, just make it a little bit more in line with how I present and how I put slides together. But it hasn't changed a whole lot. So we can go through them quickly if you want, or if you've gone through them offline and have any comments. Happy to incorporate anything.
I
I'd like to see how they look on the projector.
Sure. So the first one is the purpose.
Nitpicking, but it basically tell me to vote it down to the proposed purpose section? Or the proposed revision?
Sure.
Or how about a revised instead of the revised?
Okay. That'll, yeah.
Just so we avoid the alliteration. Proposed purpose.
Calling out the three areas in which changes have been made.
So cross out clear. It's always
cross
tricky.
Out is not clear now.
No, it's always tricky with that cross out.
I tried to, well, I called it out in that
yeah.
box. Well, you're right, you can't really tell.
Well, what you have to do is, I think, highlight it and explain that it's basically being removed.
Mm-hmm.
Because the Microsoft strikeout
yeah.
never shows right.
No.
Yeah. You're saying verbally, right? Call it out?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, basically in the text, you take the whole line and put a color box around it, a background, and then explain that that's what's being removed.
Oh, you're talking about this top line. I see.
Right.
I think we were talking about the letters. You can't tell at all that they're being struck out.
Is that top line being struck out?
Oh, letters aligned to each. Purpose have been removed. Is that true?
Yeah. All of these have been. You can almost look closely. You can see like G. You can see it's been crossed out.
I would make that top line bold if we're deleting it. 1.1.
Mm-hmm.
Because it doesn't stand out at all. It almost looks like something was on the copier when
I know
we made the print.
Make the cross out line bold.
Yeah,
yeah,
something.
No, I think I forgot to do this, but I think what we said we would do is we can do that and then have another slide with what the final bylaw is going to look like or the final section is going to look like.
But if you put it, if yes, but you can't see, I can't see that there's a, it, that just looks fuzzy, that first 1.1.
Oh yeah, absolutely. I think we need to call that out better and then just have a clean version of it.
And so if you just draw a line.
Yeah.
And diagonal line.
Forget about redlining it in Word or whatever, but just actually in
mm-hmm.
PowerPoint draw a line. You can make it as thick as you want and plug it over there.
Yeah.
And do the same for each of the letters.
Yeah.
Because
you can make it nice and thick.
Yeah.
So that you can see it.
Yep.
Yeah.
And you're going to present a slide, so you'll explain what they're doing, and then you'll say, here's the clean version of it.
Yeah. So we'll add a slide of just the clean
version. Anybody who stands up and doesn't understand that will take away their membership.
And it'll be in the warrant.
Yes. good.
Whatever. Should that say, are these just being in the presentation, or is this presentation someplace else? I mean, will people just see this for 5 seconds?
They're not going to get copied.
All right.
At least I don't think they are, right?
No.
We haven't even noticed.
I was going to say, that should just say added reference to State Zoning Act.
Oh, yeah, let's fix that. Added which references?
Yeah, just added reference to.
You see that, Gene?
Yep.
Oh, but that's good, because that would have looked at me like, that's not right. That would have bothered me. Okay.
I'm sorry, I don't need to be
labor. No, please.
The point that all these sub-bullets, used to be A through L, are the bullets, are part of this reference to Section 2A, Chapter 808.
Yeah.
That's the point that I think got lost last time. Mm. And that doesn't jump out here.
Yeah.
So.
But in his speaking, he'll say these are from that section of the code.
Yes.
And yeah. They're here to remind everyone why they exist. Yeah. You know, so that we don't lose track.
Mm-hmm.
It's okay to have them there.
Right. Okay, yeah, that's good. All right. I think we're good on purpose. Mm-hmm. We'll move to aquifer.
Curious to see what the third slide looks like with the map on it, whether it even reads right. All right, so the outlines around the titles, the little Meadowbrook Golf Course, mm-hmm. those things need to be bold and probably black, I would think, if you want them to punch, because they're just fading off. I can't see where the point of the leader is.
Yeah.
But the boundary is the red line.
Yes.
So the legend is way too small, and it's not legible from this distance. It won't be legible if you're going to keep it there. Is that actually part of the map? Is that why?
Mm-hmm.
So I wonder if you just put an overlay on top of the slide with something larger. The red line,
yeah,
just the boundary.
Recreate.
Redo the
just
map.
Just recreate the legend with font that's
okay.
Larger.
Yeah.
Okay.
As big as the Meadowbrook. As big as the other titles there.
Yep.
So just a white box on top of that.
With the, yeah.
Yep, nice and clean.
Yeah.
Okay. Slide two, I guess. The third back up before the map. It says, what is an aquifer? Why do we need this?
Mm-hmm.
And I would get rid of the word but from the third one.
Yeah.
To say, we don't use the well for our drinking water. Or we no longer use the well. Choice.
Wait, where are you looking?
The one that's what is an aquifer? This starts off with, but we don't use the wells.
And you want to delete that?
No, he's just...
Just kind of clean it up.
Got the word "but."
Oh, yeah.
I like, we no longer use the wells for our drinking.
The wells are no longer used. Does anybody write science reports? The wells. Third person or something. The wells are no longer used for drinking water. Well, they're not used for our primary drinking water, really. But they have to be maintained.
Anything else on that slide?
Do we need to do capitalization
yeah.
on all these bullets to keep it consistent?
Yeah.
Promote, preserve, conserve, prevent.
DEP requirements. Mm-hmm. Aquifer Protection District, what is it?
The DEP approved by the bylaw? Perhaps July 1996 period, strike the end.
Okay. Yep, DEP approved the bylaw on that in December 2000. So we looked at the map, and now we've got the table.
So, just in terms of a flow here, what's an aquifer? You immediately jump to why do we need an aquifer protection district and the caveat of why we need it. Then jump to the Mass DEP requirements for something. I'm not sure what those requirements are for. Are those for the requirements of a protection district? And then we go and define a protection district.
Yeah, I'm never wrestling with this one.
So
it's basically the DEP requirements is almost a parenthetical thing under why do we still have to do this? It's basically the DEP administrative consent order, and this is their authority. It's not the best, but it's not bad. I mean,
I would move the Aquifer Protection District, what is it, to that second slide.
Mm-hmm. Underneath what is an aquifer?
Yeah. Then what's an Aquifer Protection District? Why do we need it? Then we introduce, so those could all be on one slide. Then we go, the next one was, it's regulated by zoning, required by Mass DEP. The next thing you say, the requirements, then we don't use the wells for drinking water, and then you can say that's right, but we have to do it anyways, and this is how it was created. That's how I would organize it, but you're the one,
yeah, no,
you're
that
the
makes
one
sense.
Doing the talking.
That makes sense. So what is an aquifer? What is the aquifer protection district? Why do we regulate it?
Yeah. What are the regulations, which would be this MassDEP?
Yep. What are the regulations?
What's the rationale? This, we don't use the wells, and then how was it identified? And then
you can almost, I mean, how was it identified? I could probably speak to that, or we could add it to somehow have it as a call out on the boundary slide.
Sure. You could probably quickly put that under the legend, because the legend doesn't have to have everything on it, just a few of the mm-hmm. boundaries and the colors.
You get all that?
Yeah.
Yeah, when you call up the map, you could have it as a note and just talk about how it was identified.
Yeah.
Which, that is important.
Yeah.
Right,
yeah.
We've heard a lot of times about it being random.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Well, I've lost track of the overall order, but the thing about that we no longer use the well for drinking water might directly follow the how is it identified. Mm. It was identified as XYZ while we still were using the well, but now we're not. We still have to have it.
Yeah. Let's see how it, can we see how it looks the first order? Because I think that was kind of like what Dave's saying too. Can we try it the first time and just run
yeah.
it by me and
yeah.
we can tweak it from there?
Yeah, I'll work on it and send you the draft.
Yeah. And then for the tables, I tried to add a little bit of so what to it. I know people had certain things that they were pretty spun up about, particularly the artificial recharge, and how they're not, how we don't require them anymore for residential units.
Right.
So I called that out specifically. But
and the underground storage tank was a big thing.
Yes.
Bottom line is this simplifies how you get there. We went from a complex requirement of artificial recharge systems that there was a lot of concern that it was expensive, and now
yeah.
it can be done simply with rain gardens.
Yeah.
That's a big change.
And the fact that we're specifically saying that only that portion within the APD is subject to these requirements,
right?
Not the entire portion,
right?
Yeah.
And they'll ask you what you mean by that, and you'll explain it. Just tell them you have a big lot, and only a tiny little tip in the back or is in the APD. Only that little portion, if it's affected, has to comply.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, and it's, you know, in the proposed slide, it might be worth just underlying the only applies to the portion of the lot.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
At that point, everybody will raise their hands and vote for it.
I think it probably would it be helpful to pull those two points out?
About the impervious?
Well, there's room on the slide. You could.
Well, just in the sense that you could, and you know, it's there's a potential to get lost in the minutia of the, we're deleting this, we're deleting that, and changing this. You know, as long as when you present it, that's the crux of the issue there, not the changing the definitions.
Yeah, I would push the last two items down on that slide so he's got a little more room, and separate area threshold from impervious and make that those two points bold. I think that'll make them stand out, and then when you talk to them, those points, you can elaborate on them and really highlight them.
Do you think it would be better not to use a chart and just individually have a slide on just what the impervious area now, how we're interpreting that, and then a separate slide on the deletion of non-conforming and then a violation notice? Or does that make it too?
I don't know. I think that this is all right. I mean, the fact that we're deleting things is good.
Yeah,
that was always one of our mandates to kind of clean it up, simplify it. But I think I like this idea of kind of putting more emphasis on these two bullets.
Mm-hmm. The other, doesn't this line up now with requirements from DEP?
Mm-hmm. Yep.
As opposed to being more strict.
Yeah.
More strict.
Yep.
And I think that's important that I because you don't really want to do away with the whole thing, and you don't want to make it too strict, and that's the sense here, mm-hmm. is that it provides some protection. But it's not burdensome.
Well, isn't that that point is sort of missing from our list here?
Right.
Yes.
But I mean, we basically, it's not specifically the non-conforming uses and structures, but we basically realigned or relaxed the use restrictions to line up or to meet the existing DEP. That's worthy of another bullet, perhaps.
So let's see how, because we did make a number of revisions here, let's see how it kind of looks, and then
okay.
we can figure out the right place to add that.
Yeah.
I was definitely planning to mention that, but I think you're right, it's worth writing down.
Well, I mean, it's one extra slide.
Right.
If you want to group together the deleted things and emphasize some of the others.
That's true, yeah.
And please don't use the word duplicative.
What's that?
Under why delete non-conforming.
Redundant? Or not at all?
Why don't you say already covered? Which delete?
Or just unnecessary.
So it's supposed to say, the second sentence in that same paragraph, it's supposed to say, only if there is an increase in the non-conformance, or is the parentheses in the wrong spot? It says in the non-conforming.
Non-conformity?
I'm just wondering if it's supposed to be a non-conforming area, or is it, what is it that's non-conforming? Only if there's an increase in the non-conforming, it must be non-conformance.
Yeah, I think it is. WSF. This one was no fun.
Personal wireless service or a service facility? What's the F?
Service facility.
Facilities.
Right, so the title on that second slide is the title of the zoning called Personal Wireless Service Facilities Zoning Bylaw?
Mm-hmm.
Slide previous to this, though, it says current bylaw does not conform with. I think it's supposed to either be conform to or comply with, I think.
Okay.
No? That's how I've always heard it. Conform with? Conform to.
To conform to.
Yep.
Or you could say comply with, whichever you prefer.
Yeah, we'll keep conform.
Now, where's that slide? Lose track or something?
Which one?
That one.
In general.
General.
It comes after this one.
64. Found it.
Instead of no indication of siting parameters, does not include facility siting parameters, and on the next bullet add, instead of does not address the demonstration of need, does not require the applicant to provide a demonstration of need.
That one right there, Gene?
Yeah. Say that again, I'm sorry.
Here.
I
antennas, Nick? You get antennas before?
Sorry, can you get the end?
And no, isn't the antenna get some?
Where are we at?
Installation types.
Thanks. Looks right.
Is it okay? Page 66 of the desk packet, the top slide. I'll double check it.
No, ant. Antenna, antenna. Singular.
Well, antenna is singular. Antenna, AE, is plural.
Well, it says a new antenna tower. It's just, it's not reading well because it looks like everything's bold, even though it's not.
Something with the font, maybe, I don't know.
It's just not enough white space on the page.
Yeah.
So if you left the title, say the four doc fourth preference bold, and you made everything else after that, you might have to take it down a font. Because in the printed page, you can see the difference between bold and not bold. But
right.
You may need to take it down 1 point. And there should be a hanging indent on the paragraphs.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, on the printed version.
Yes, actually, the print is correct. The print reads fine. It could use a little more white space, but it's not as bad as the slide up there.
Yep.
The other thing is the last, the second to last and third to last slides, those tables aren't going to read. That purple with the black, it doesn't print well, for sure. This just, no one's going to see that. So I'd be careful with those colors.
Yeah, we can pick some different colors.
Yep.
Yeah, and spacing.
I mean, you could make the top header black and use white font, and then you can just leave the rest of it white. I don't know why you need the purple.
Going to have to do a presentation for the one that we just voted on earlier?
I think Bob's going to handle those.
Okay. I figured this is both ZBA and us.
Yeah.
Okay.
Is there a way that's the setbacks?
Yeah.
There's a lot there.
There's a lot of information.
Oh. Is there a way summarize it? I'm just afraid that you
get rid of all the articles. Minimum distance from base
that
you can
end up
summarize
on.
Mm-hmm.
You know, reading it because you feel like you have to. And
yeah,
let's look at simplifying some of that language. It doesn't have to be exactly verbatim as long as
just try to call that down into
The version, though, that we've got up here is different from the version in our packet. Because there's definitely some formatting differences.
Oh, really?
So I just want to make sure we're... I haven't noticed any language changes there. I have noticed some formatting changes. Like, if you look at setbacks, all of the...
Yeah.
The dashes are lined up.
Yeah.
With the indent.
But there's still a lot of words here.
Yeah, yeah, absolutely.
So I like that last, the bottom one.
Right. Right.
I wonder if that's because it's in Google Docs.
It could be, yeah.
Maybe. That might be following it up.
Okay, cool. Because the language still, it looks like the language.
Yes.
Yeah, their Google Docs previewer is...
Yeah.
Okay, thanks, folks, for taking the time to go through that.
Okay, I'll get that worked up and send it off to you.
Okay, thank you.
Okay.
All right. Next up, planning updates and other business. Library project, retaining wall design.
Yes. So they, this you might remember was a wall that I don't know if they were 100% sure about when they drew up the plans, but when they were doing the work, they realized the wall failed. And so they're replacing it with a poured concrete wall. It's really not a big deal, and we thought, Jesse and I talked about it, we thought to let the project not get hung up, we could do this administratively. In your packet, you can see the previous approved one and then the proposed change. It's fairly similar. I think the only key difference is the ornamental fence now is on top of the wall as opposed to behind it.
Okay, so this is from the point of view of the building picture here. This is the one that runs straight back on the right.
Deering?
Yes.
Or?
If you're facing the Deering, I think it is Deering. If you're facing the front of the library on Middlesex, it's that street right. That runs to the right.
They were questioning this. Did they question it from the onset?
They've always had some initial concern about whether or not that wall was going to hold up. And it's not.
But I think they were also interested, isn't there the stairs or something in the center of the wall? So that you don't have to walk up the driveway?
Yeah.
To get to the parking.
There's concrete steps in the middle.
Yes, yeah, so location of new concrete steps within.
See them? They're just north of the old steps.
Right. That was one of the things they were concerned to make sure that stayed there.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
And this doesn't...
It's there.
...bust the budget or anything?
No, I think they had the contingency, so...
Yeah.
So, like I said, just we wanted to make you aware of that, but we approved it administratively. Just keep it going.
Yep.
You good, John?
Yeah. Are these to the same scale?
Well, they are because the existing condition doesn't show the fence, but the proposed thing does.
Well, the John's right. The top plan, John, has a break on the left side. See it? The new wall has a break line on the left side in the length of the wall, it looks like. And that would make up the difference in length anyways.
Yeah, okay.
But the idea here, and because you can't tell, I can't. The wall isn't higher substantially, right?
No, I think it's the same, 4 feet. The one thing that they did say was, as you go all the way down Daring, there's a little piece that they're not going to be able to deal with because it's so close to an existing garage that they're worried that they could breach that garage. It looked like the wall literally goes right up to the garage. So I don't think they'll leave a portion of the old wall for some of it, but it's just a small little piece that they just didn't feel comfortable getting into.
Okay. Everything going well over there?
I think it is, yeah. Moving right along.
Yeah, everyone's busy. Pretty good, yeah. Okay. What other updates do you have?
I think the big thing is we're trying to get the community development director position filled. Anyone knows anyone, it's a great place to work. other thing that came in was the YMCA is interested in new signage. And that's an interesting thing because in our sign bylaw, we have a exemption clause for federally tax-exempt institutions. And so they are exempt from that zone.
I don't think the Supreme Court says that anymore. It's like content-based. Funded-based. I don't know. Sorry. Nobody's exempt from anything. And nobody's subject to anything.
That would be nice. But town council weighed in and said, yeah, they're exempt. So what they want to do is pretty elaborate. I can pass it around. Essentially, they want to put in a big freestanding sign with a reader board, changeable messages, and or a big wall sign.
Just goes right along with the school committee that does whatever they want anyway, so good.
Hand changeable reader board?
Yes.
So I encourage them to maybe have a meeting with the neighbors to see what might work best for the neighborhood, regardless of what zoning might dictate or not. And I'm not sure if that was.
Neighborhood right where that sign is going, right? There's
but
no one along.
Draw a ring and maybe.
Well, there's the Coolidge School, whatever it is.
Right. I mean, the neighborhood is a community space, not a residential space.
So I'm not sure where that, I was out for the past 2 weeks. That was what Jesse left for me. Among other things.
This is a lighted
sign. Welcome back from vacation here.
Have fun dealing with
this. This is a backlighted sign. Do you want to make it backlit? The
Internally
illuminated reader board.
No.
Because it doesn't get any tackier than that, and they can't figure out something else. It's pretty tacky.
I was working with them, encouraging them to think about the wall sign.
I mean, the logo piece of it's kind of decent, although is that supposed to be internally illuminated too?
I'm not sure.
It looks like just the graphic is from this night view one.
So it's hanging out there somewhere.
I'll just say this. A reader board sign with removable letters at ground level in an area that is not subject to constant visibility. Near a school, you're going to get all kinds of words. Okay? That's from a juvenile delinquent telling you that. So I think it's a bad idea. It's going to get modified.
remind them.
Remind them of it.
That's why I wanted to let you know that this was pending.
It's going to get modified.
I mean, I'd almost rather them put up an LED, like a digitally interchangeable sign if they're going to do that, because then at least they can control it from inside.
The real concern, aside from the sign itself, is the location they're putting it in. I think where they're putting this in is that's a hard intersection. Lots of kids, the crossing guard there. I don't know if anyone had a kid to go to college, but Birch Meadow, that's a very tough location to have that sign blocking visibility.
Yeah,
right.
I asked the police chief to look at it.
It's hard to tell exactly from this, but that may be.
And that may be something Glenn would get into anyway.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Kids would be hiding behind that.
And then the other thing is that there was a DRT for the revised proposal from Criterion Child Enrichment 186 Summer Rav. I was not here for that, but it was September 2nd.
Well, the narrative was just that they were going to preserve the existing buildings and do the underground connectivity or connection between them.
Yep.
But they're
and use the barn. Before, they weren't going to really use the barn.
They're going to go before the historic,
the HDC,
the West Street, yeah, whatever it is.
Yep.
Before they connect to us.
Yep.
Only if they pass that hurdle would they connect to us.
Correct.
Okay. Right.
And we already talked last time about the 40B that got approved. I haven't seen any more on that. It was interesting that they had pretty strongly worded conditions of approval. This is the big one down at the train station.
Right.
77 units on 30,000 square feet.
Say that again?
They had strongly worded conditions as part of the approval.
Do any of those help with the 77 unit portion of it?
Well, yes and no. You know, the fire chief had some pretty strong, serious concerns. And they said that, obviously, they want those concerns to be addressed. And part of that had to do with the height, being able to get up there with the apparatus. So
here's another concern I was thinking about. So all of those residents could go to town hall and get a sticker and essentially double their parking spaces, because they could park in the depot lot and use their parking space for their guests.
But there's no overnight parking there.
No, but during the day, early in the morning, and things like that. You know, so you're talking about significantly probably reducing the amount of parking available at the depot. Unless there's some kind of plan in place.
Yeah. Probably on the weekends that's not so bad. You know. It does raise an issue.
They shouldn't be allowed to get the sticker. Residential units. Residential buildings with 70 or more units. Within 300 feet of a depot. We can write this.
It's not like they need
right
access to the dump, so.
They should be walking to the depot. That's the whole, one of their points probably for saying that they are allowed to put this there is they're saying they're within walking distance of the depot.
Yeah.
So they don't need parking at the depot.
Let's see how it shakes out.
Mm. Right. Make sure they have the black bordered resident permits.
Yeah.
Yep.
Okay.
Anything else?
I think that's it for now.
Okay. Do you want to knock out these minutes?
Just go with the sign.
Got it.
Yeah.
Thank you.
In the fifth paragraph, Melinda Richardson, I would get rid of the just. Wanted to know. Just say she wanted to know. I don't know that she just wanted to know. In the next paragraph, second line there, it should say there if there are already 24. Which reads in there, if there are. Same page, third paragraph up from the bottom, Bruce McKenzie, that one.
Mm-hmm.
Second sentence towards the end, it should say probably add one more.
Okay.
Is accidentally the right word?
What is that?
Or is it accidentally?
It looks right.
I'm saying it is. It just looks right.
I think it's accidentally the way it is, yeah. I don't think it's Tully. Top paragraph on the next page, dividends and causeway roads. Add the word roads.
Top of page 3, Bruce McKenzie asked, why only a portion? Just the missing word.
What was it?
Asked why.
Asked. Oh.
So second paragraph on that third page, it's the second sentence, incorporated to the version of the change, I think it's change as included.
So it should say, were incorporated into the version of the changes included in the package?
Into the version?
Yeah. Or in, either way.
In the review draft town meeting presentation, we recommended 2-2 among the people.
2-2.
Under planning updates, the third paragraph. Second line, this is PDC, I think the C is missing, CPDC.
CPDC.
Move that the CPDC approve the minutes for the meeting of August 24th, 2015 as amended.
Do we have a second?
Yeah, second.
Before you vote on that, under planning updates, the the fourth paragraph. Is that right? Is that really what was said?
No, it's a lot more involved than this.
I think she said that not that this makes it sound like
there's an existing Jesse, case.
Yeah, there's an existing case that she can't talk about because it was discussed in legislature. The point there was that at the time, it was discussed in an executive session, so she doesn't know what was said in that executive session.
That's right.
And I don't know how to rephrase that.
Let's try this.
It's different than what's said here.
Right. We're discussed only in executive session.
Well, it should change. It should say, Ms. Wilson noted there was a litigation case, I'd say regarding a lot in Reading, that she cannot speak too much on because the details were discussed in executive session, period. However, town council had recommended a change in zoning to allow this lot to be built upon. And the rest of that's weird.
Yeah, that's good.
Which would settle the litigation, I guess. And then I guess I would change what I said was really that I was concerned about making zoning decisions without having all the information in general.
Do you know if we were able to get our hands on those meeting
minutes? I asked about it and the town manager said he can't release it yet. Okay. I think there's some other things in there, which is why the meeting minutes can't be released yet.
Okay. Do we know if that property got a variance on height as well?
I don't think it exceeds the height. I think Glenn went out and looked at it.
That's pretty tall.
Yeah, I'm not exactly sure, but I...
Okay, but we don't think there's a variance on height.
I don't think there's a variance. I think he was comfortable with it.
Okay.
Could change.
All right. All those in favor?
Move to adjourn.
Second.
All those in favor? Folks. So we've canceled our next meeting, right?
Yes.
So our next meeting is the 5th, October 5th.